for today's virtual CPE meeting, Demystifying Bitcoin with Mr. Pradeep Rajagopalan. But before I call upon C.H. Sriram to introduce the speaker, let me just make certain announcements that I have. 2020 is CA Day and is also the launch of e-newsletter Jagruti. I am sure you all have seen the notification sent by email and WhatsApp. We have intentionally tried to keep this event in the evening so that you all can participate. It is a brief event from 6 p.m. to 6:30 p.m. I request you all to attend the event and make it a success. We will be having ICI President Shri Atul Gupta ji by meager show of strength. It's on 1st of July, 6 p.m. Come 3rd of July, Friday, we have organized an online general knowledge quiz for members and families. This is the first time ever something like this have been planned. A general knowledge quiz competition for the families, and that to a virtual one. It would definitely be very interesting, and I hope everyone participates. It's a Friday in the evening, 4:30, or I think 4 o'clock. If you have not registered, please do so as soon as possible. There are prizes to be won too. On demand and insistence of a lot of our members, we will be having one more health session. Fight Corona with, so it's a power packed week, 1st of July, CA Day. 3rd of July quiz competition, and on 4th of July morning 10 o'clock would be the yoga session. More details will follow for the yoga session. The last thing is, given the current situation and the travel restrictions, we have initiated and progressed with a Kuwait chapter's request to Institute of Chartered Accountants to make Kuwait an examination center. In this regard, we had sent a mail out to all the members by WhatsApp and a mail, of course. And it was stipulated that you could send it to your friends and colleagues, and a survey was to be conducted so that we could know that the number of children or students who would like to appear for exams in Kuwait, for inter and for final. In this regard, we've got a very overwhelming response. The survey is closing on 11th of July. We still hope you will talk to your friends, and if there are a few more who would like to take the survey, and let us know that how many students are there who would intend appearing for the exams in Kuwait. So please ask them and fill the survey as soon as possible. And last but not the least, a humble request to members to pay up your fees for 2020-21. We've stopped calling members, we've stopped irritating them, which we used to do once upon a time. And we think we all members are very responsible and professionals and ethical. So you would probably come forward, pay your fees as soon as possible without we reminding you again and again. With that, let me hand over to C.H. Sriram to introduce the speaker and carry forward the proceedings of the evening. Thank you very much. C.H. Sriram.
Thank you, Kaiser. Thank you very much. That's indeed a lineup of events, and I'm sure our members would be looking forward eagerly to attend all the sessions. Now, I would be introducing Mr. Pradeep. It's my honor and my privilege to be introducing Pradeep Rajagopalan. Pradeep is currently the director and head of internal audit at CAMCO investment company, CAMCO Invest. He has over 24 years of experience in leading various organizations. CAMCO, of course, as all of us know, is one of the largest asset managers in Kuwait with a significant asset under management. Pradeep heads a team of analysts and professionals with overall responsibility for internal audit, investigation, special audits, and related risks and controls. Prior to working with CAMCO, Pradeep was the head of risk management and compliance at Kuwait Finance Center, which is Markaz, as all of us know. Pradeep joined Markaz in 2005 from Standard Chartered Bank, where he was a unit manager for credit risk control of corporate clients based out of Middle East. And prior to Standard Chartered Bank, Pradeep was with the ICICI Group, where he worked on venture capital investments, project financing, and structuring banking products. And that's a very, I would say, tall line of experience. And we are really privileged to have you, Mr. Pradeep Rajagopalan. Coming to the list of qualifications that Pradeep has behind his name, it is again a very, very impressive list, which most of us would really look forward to even one of them to be in it. So allow me to take you through the train of the qualifications that Pradeep has. He is primarily a bachelor degree holder in mechanical engineering from Indian Railways Institute of Mechanical and Engineering, Electrical Engineering. He is an MBA with the premier institute that we all know as IIM Ahmedabad. He has specialized in finance and systems from the institute. Pradeep is a CFA charter holder from the CFA Institute in USA. He has an FRM and ERP certification from GARP, USA. And he is a CFE certificate holder from the Institute of Certified Fraud Examiners. And that's from the USA as well. And he has a CAMS certification from ACAMS USA. Pradeep is an active volunteer with the CFA Kuwait Society and has served the society in various capacities. So Pradeep, it's our honor, all of us, to invite you to share your valuable inputs with us for the evening today. Without much ado and wasting any much further time, I hand over the dais to Mr. Pradeep Rajagopalan. And here we have Pradeep. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Sriram. Thank you for those excellent words. It's my honor and privilege to be in such an audience. Today, we will look at Bitcoin from ground up, at the first principle. So hopefully, we'll have a very interactive session.
I'm sorry to interrupt, Mr. Pradeep. I think there is some internet issue with respect to the volume. So, Rohit, is it fine? Are everybody able to hear?
No, right now we are not able to hear, Mr. Pradeep.
No, there is some internet issue, audio issue.
Okay, 1 minute. I'll just switch my connection.
Sorry for the inconvenience, members. This is all, we have to rely on the internet and the audio and the...
Yeah.
Yeah, Pradeep.
Yeah. So we can see the screen.
Yeah, we can hear you, Mr. Pradeep. I would just like to add to all the members that as Mr. Pradeep presents the session today, we will have a few polling questions which will be coming our way. And I request all members to be mindful of that. And as and when it comes, I would request all of us to respond to it as and when the polls come up. In addition, Mr. Pradeep also has a few questions for us, which he would be posing. And all members are requested to respond and give their answers in the chat window. You know, so you could type in the chat window and give the answers. Rohit, CA Rohit, who is our coordinator here, he will collect all the, he'll compile all the answers. And then, you know, he will present it towards the end of the Q&A session. So that is the logistic announcement, which I missed out last when I was in the dais. So over to you, Mr. Pradeep, please take over.
Thank you, Sriram. The objective is to learn a little bit about Bitcoin and also have fun on the day. So I'll be asking a lot of questions. As Sriram mentioned, we'll be addressing the questions. The presentation has a couple of slides that summarizes the key aspects. That will answer a lot. Thank you. So today's presentation, we'll be looking at four components. We would look at the need for Bitcoin. What is the business case for Bitcoin? We would be looking at the technology behind Bitcoin, a little bit on the risks and challenges, and of course, lastly, what is the takeaway for all of us? So moving on to the business case for Bitcoin. Let me start with something very simple, a lock and key. Now, this is a very famous handmade Indian lock. So first question to the audience, can you guess the origin of this lock? Where is this lock from? Rohit, any responses?
I think we have not received any response. It's a Godrej or India.
We are receiving responses.
We have few responses. India, Aligarh. Mainly it's
Awesome. So this is a handmade Aligarh lock. You would have seen it in your grandparents or your parents' homes. Very sturdy lock. Now, unfortunately, we have a number of imported and Chinese locks. So this art is kind of dying down. So the lock, why I bought a lock is, I want to start from fundamentals. A lock represents safety. It represents a symbol of wealth. Obviously, if you have something important, that's what you will protect. It is also a symbol of privilege. You know, bigger the man, bigger the lock, or bigger the safe. And of course, it's a signal. So when you lock something, you tell people it's important and you wanted to keep it protected. So to summarize, a lock essentially symbolizes confidentiality. You are able to keep your things safe. And a key is used to grant access. Now we will be looking at this lock and key thread while we discuss Bitcoin. Moving on, what are the characteristics of a good lock? All of you know it, but a quick summary. So a lock is only supposed to open for the designated key reliably. A lock should withstand what's called brute force attack. So even if you try multiple times, a lock should not open. And moving on to a key should open a lock reliably multiple times and should be portable. So you don't want to carry a 10 kilo key. You want a key which fits in your pocket. So it should be portable. And of course, as the diagram shows, it should be able to withstand hacking. Now, the lock and key analogy can be extended to a number of things. So for example, the reason why we are having this Zoom call is because of COVID. And a lot of biological systems use a lock and key mechanism. So here is the second question for you. The COVID virus has a key which it uses to unlock a particular receptor on the human epithelial cells. So any guesses, what is this lock called? Rohit, let me know if you get a response.
It's RNA. We received a few answers as RNA.
Yeah, it's an RNA virus. But it has a protein protrusion which it uses like a key to unlock a specific receptor on the human epithelial cells.
So it's a ACE2, somebody responded on ACE2.
Sorry, I think there was some disruption there. Yeah, we got
disconnected. Yeah, it's like somebody responded ACE2 receptor also.
I'm sorry. One minute. Let me share my screen.
Yeah, Pradeep. Yeah, we received a few answers. It was like somebody responded spike and ACE2 receptor.
Yeah, okay, ACE2 receptor. Yeah, awesome. So the lock and key analogy can be extended to other areas. Like, for example, online games, they are looking at using biometrics as your key to unlock some of these games. On an unrelated field, a lot of the nuclear power nations put in an elaborate system of multiple lock and keys to ensure people don't launch off missiles by mistake. And then we are all busy, spending time during lockdown watching Netflix. So Netflix is again looking at using a online lock and key version to prevent password cheats. Now, essentially, when we look at a lock and key, what we are looking at is trust. A lock and key divides your world into a trusted zone and the outside zone. So you want to bridge this gap. Now, I won't be wrong if I say trust underpins all business transactions. Or if you can strike that, trust underpins all transactions. Now, let's take a case. Typically, let's say you go to the market to buy onions. What will happen is you will go to the shopkeeper and ask him how much is the onion. Let's say he says 50 rupees. Say, no, bhaiya, this is too much. And then he says, no, 50 rupees. No, there is no supply. And you say, okay, achha, give me some extra dhaniya. So what happens is a business transaction goes through the following stages. You have an offer. You have an acceptance where you say, okay, 50 rupees. Then you have delivery and then you have payment. Now, sometimes the delivery and payments are switched. Let's say you want to buy a car, then the delivery and payments get switched. Now, this entire transaction is made secure by two concepts. One is integrity. In this example, what would be integrity? Integrity is when you come home and you open the bag and you realize you've been given potatoes instead of onion, you will feel cheated. So you don't want that to happen. And the other important characteristic is non-repudiation. Non-repudiation is where, for example, you give him 50 rupees and you say, you never give me money. So you don't want that to happen. So elaborating on these two concepts. Now, these concepts are kind of backbone for the Bitcoin architecture. So that's why I'm spending a little bit of time on this. So what is integrity? Integrity has two components. One is, can outsiders be kept out? Now, whenever you look at a legal agreement, you say this agreement is between party A and party B. So you don't want any third party in the agreement. The other component of integrity is what's called fairness. Now, if it's not fairness, then it's no longer business, it becomes exploitation. So courts and the legal system is to ensure that the entire transaction is fair. Moving on, non-repudiation in Hindi is what's called mukar jana, which is you don't want people to back out of a transaction once a transaction is done. And this is particularly important when you are doing high volume online transactions where you don't want this problem of people backing out. So in our, let's say, Saptiwala example, you know, it works both ways. You could have the Saptiwala telling you, sorry, I already gave it to somebody else. Or even from the customer side, you know, you have people saying, give me this karbuza, and then they say, cut it, and after cutting it, they say, sorry, I don't want it. So non-repudiation has two components. One is origin, where you say, I didn't send the transfer. So imagine if some client says, I didn't send the transfer, then you have the agreement and the transfer slip to prove it. Or sometimes you say, I sent the transfer, but the amount is wrong. So these are non-repudiation of origin and emission. And a lot of effort is has been put in the Bitcoin architecture to take care of these issues. Now, how do we bridge this trust gap in a typical transaction? Now, one way is to have what's called a central counterparty. So a central counterparty essentially ensures that the buyer and seller can do business easily. So for example, your central counterparties could be things like bank or borsa. So whenever you do a share purchase transaction in the stock market, your counterparty is the stock market. So you never know who you are buying or selling it from. So central counterparties typically guarantee transaction and reduce friction. Now let's say I go for a dinner with Rohit and I owe him 30 pounds. So I can either give him this IOU on the left hand side, or I can give him this colored paper. Now Rohit, you will obviously prefer the colored paper on the right despite my poor drawing. That's because this is not an ordinary paper. This has the backing of the central authority. And the central authority kind of guarantees this transaction and reduces friction. So let's take a quick look at the evolution of money. You initially had barter, then we moved on to gold, then precious metal coins, paper money, plastic money, electronic, and now we are looking at cryptocurrency. Now, if you look at the kind of centralization of power, or if you can say the central counterparties, here's the graph. Barter, there is virtually no centralization. It's between you and me. I have two goats and you have one horse. You want the goats, I want the horse, deal done. So there's nothing to it. Gold, a little bit of centralization because you want somebody to authenticate that the gold is genuine. And similarly for paper money, of course, there's a central bank in between. For plastic, you have Visa or MasterCard in between. But the interesting thing is for cryptocurrencies, we want to eliminate the central party. Now, even for large central parties, like let's say, for example, banks don't trust each other. They go through RBI. So there's an elaborate RBI claim. So if you are bank A and bank B, they go through a central counterparty, which ensures that the transaction goes through smoothly between them. So I just put a small schematic of the interaction between various banks. And I'm sure all of you watch movies. In the movie Dhamal, it says, हर एक बाप का एक एक और बाप होता है और उसे हम दादाजी कहते हैं. सो देयर आर लॉट ऑफ दीस हायरार्किकल सेंट्रल काउंटर पार्टीज. नाउ वन एडवांटेज ऑफ बीइंग अ दादाजी और अ सेंट्रल काउंटर पार्टी इज स्ट्रांग सेंट्रल काउंटर पार्टी इज यू कैन इशू बॉन्ड्स, यू कैन टैप मनी फ्रॉम पब्लिक. सो हियर इज एन एग्जांपल ऑफ अ बॉन्ड. आई जस्ट वांटेड टू लुक एट अ कपल ऑफ थिंग्स. सो दिस बॉन्ड हैज बीन इशूड बाय द इंपीरियल गवर्नमेंट ऑफ रशिया बैक्ड बाय लेजर ऑफ पब्लिक डेट. सो इट इज an obligation on all the people. It is exempt from every tax. And if you look at the date 1894, there's a question for you. What is the significance of this bond? Any guesses? Right, let me know when you get some answers.
Pradeep, I think question was not clear.
Okay, the question is, this bond was issued in 1894. What is the significance of that date? Okay, let me answer the question. This bond was issued at the height of the Romanov's power. Bonds and similar bonds are responsible for the Russian Revolution. So, 1918, when the Russian Revolution was overthrown and the communists came to power. So, bonds like these are what triggered that. So, essentially, the question is, central counterparties radiate trust, but what if the central counterparty abuses that trust? Now, let's look at one more example. So this is the story of dollar from 1913 to 2013, which is over a period of 100 years. Now, if you look at the decline in the purchasing value of dollar from $1 all the way down to 5 cents in 2013. And I think if you look at today's condition, it will be even much more worse. So what exactly happens here? Who is paying for all this? Is it the US taxpayer or is it you and me? Now, typically, we would think it is the US taxpayer, but because of the dollar's central status in the world currencies, you and I are paying for it. Now, one way to look at it is you can say that, okay, my grandfather had a salary of 100 rupees. I have a salary of, let's say, 1 lakh of rupees per month. So I really don't care, you know, if there's inflation or if it loses the value, so what? The problem with rapid devaluation or central counterparty not honoring the trust is that it creates a kind of social unrest. Now let's look at another example, which is the Roman Empire. So here you have the Roman Empire, which why the Roman Empire? Because they used to keep very elaborate records, and they were ruling over 1/4 of the population for a long time, over 500 years. So the Roman Empire used to have this currency called denarius. The root word for Kuwaiti dinar and Bahraini dinar. So the dinar word comes from Roman currency denarius. So the denarius was, when it started, was about 3.9 grams of silver. And of course, as all of you know, the Roman Empire was very keen to keep fighting its neighbors and always expanding. So they needed money to finance their war. Now, very tempting to keep devaluating a currency. Here we have an example of devaluation of currency. So from 3.9, they managed to devalue it to almost negligible. So from a currency backed by silver, they went all the way to a paper currency equivalent. Now again, the same question, if devaluation happens, so what? My salary is going up, I don't care. Now interestingly, if you look at the period between 3 and 4, where devaluation was maximum, this is the period when maximum number of Roman Caesars got killed. Caesars getting killed is not an ordinary event. It shows that there are a lot of angry people. And if Caesar is not able to take care of himself, you can imagine the plight of ordinary people. So essentially, central counterparties are good. But what happens is central counterparties don't behave, or the central counterparty abuses the trust. So this is where we come to the Bitcoin story. The 2008 crisis, I think many of us have lived through those dark periods. The 2008 crisis was a crisis of large financial institutions. So when this crisis happened, there were a number of individuals and entities who felt very upset about the whole way the crisis was affecting the common man. And failure of central authority resulted in the publication of this Bitcoin peer-to-peer electronic cash system white paper. So this is the start of the Bitcoin journey. Now a question for you, what is the nationality of this gentleman, Satoshi Nakamoto? Any guesses? Rohit, any answers?
Yeah, some are telling Japanese, some are telling pseudonym. So mainly people are telling Japanese.
Okay, awesome. The guys who said pseudonym got it right. He's not a real individual. Nobody knows the true identity of this gentleman. In this sense, the pseudonym, obviously somebody brilliant published architecture and put it online. Now, so I'll elaborate a little bit more on the history of Bitcoin a little later. But essentially what the Bitcoin story is all about is movement from a central authority to a peer-to-peer concept. What do I mean by peer? All of us know the character. I think some of us have read the comics of you know, this character. Then there's one more character from you know, Hollywood. Any guesses? What is this character? Who is this character? Rohit, any answers? Who is this character on the right? The one with the sword.
I think everybody is answering for the Phantom, Rambo, Conan.
Yeah, Conan the Barbarian. So this was the movie which launched Arnold Schwarzenegger. Now the fascination with Phantom, Conan, Captain America, all these characters is that they are characters who have their own inherent strength. They don't derive their strength from any central authority. So they are essentially standing on their own merit. And this is what the Bitcoin architecture is all about. So the Bitcoin story is about movement from a highly centralized system to a peer-to-peer system where each entity stands on its own. Now, to give you a more concrete example, let us say you want to buy olive oil. Now, there are two approaches to buy olive oil. One is you look for this Eggmark logo, or you look for ISI or ISI logo or Saudi standards, or you know, one of those seal kind of thing which says this oil is good. Now this is an example of a central authority certifying the oil. So you rely on a central authority certification. On the other hand, you can have another approach. You can look at this little innovation which a olive oil producer has done in Tunisia. So what the olive oil producer has done is using blockchain technology, which is the backbone of Bitcoin architecture, it has published the entire traceability of every olive oil bottle online. You can log online and you can see when the olives for this bottle were harvested, when it was crushed, when it was stored, where it went to the store, and how did it. So the entire thing is on using blockchain technology online. On the left, you have a central authority which kind of tells you, okay, this is good. And on the right, you have a system which is kind of self-obvious. So that was a little bit of background on why Bitcoin and the triggers behind Bitcoin. So now we move on to the technology part of Bitcoin. Okay, let's start with something simple. Let's start with a simple message sent between two parties, A and B. So A wants to send a message to B. So A says, okay, let's meet at 3 o'clock. Fairly straightforward, nobody cares. But let's say A sends a message to B saying, give so much money to another person, Jim. Now, worldwide, banking transactions and financial transactions are extremely confidential. So you want to ensure that your banking data is secret. In the sense, for example, in many cultures, you know, the father doesn't know what the son's banking account is, and the husband doesn't know what the wife's banking account is. So this is fairly sensitive data. So case one, A sends message to B, give $500, straightforward. Now what happens if C gets in between? So Alice sends a message to Bob, give 500, and Carol jumps in. So Carol hears that message. It is a little uncomfortable, so you don't want a third party listening on to this. Now let's take another exchange. Carol jumps in the middle of this transaction. So what does C does? It jumps in the middle of this transaction, manipulates it. So instead of give 500 to Jim, it is give 500 to Tim. So when Bob gets this instruction, he thinks Alice has sent it. So he just goes and gives it to Tim. So you don't want this happening. This is what is called the man in the middle problem. So you don't want to have the man in the middle problem when you do transactions. And this is one of the key problems which Bitcoin tries to solve. Now, one way out of it is to use encryption. So let's go on. Case 4. Alice sends the same message to Bob, but now she uses encryption. So she's put it in quotes and she sends a key separately in a separate channel. So now, if you see, Carol cannot see this message. She cannot understand, make head and tail of this message. Now, for a lot of the history buffs, you will know that one of the reasons why the Allies, the British, won the World War II is because they managed to crack this Enigma code which was used by the Germans. Germans were very proud of the code and they thought it was unbreakable, but the British managed to crack it, and towards the later part of the war, they could kind of know what the Germans were up to. So what happens if Carol gets the key? So Alice is sending the message to Bob, encrypted message, and then she's sending the key separately. What if Carol gets the key? She gets to see the message. Now take another extreme case where Alice sent a message to Bob, but Carol got in between the message, intercepted the message, and changed the key. So when Bob gets the message, he sees an encrypted message with a different key, and instead of giving money to Jim, he gives it to Tim. So this one key system obviously has a lot of flaws. It is not sustainable. How do we solve it? Now, one way to solve it is we go back to Bollywood. Now, if you see a lot of the 60s, 70s movies, you have the, you know, gold landing up at Mud Island, right? The smuggler is coming up with a gold. And how does he know that the other party is the one to trust? In the beginning of the movie, they tear a note. One half of the note is with one guy, the other half is with another guy. And when they meet to exchange the gold, they just match the currency and that's it. So this is a trustless system. This is a system which doesn't rely on anything other than this key matching. So the backbone for Bitcoin is what's called a two-key system. Now, all of us have encountered a two-key system. So can you give an example where you have encountered a two-key system? Rohit, let me know the responses. So all of us encounter two-key systems in our day-to-day life, physical. So let me move on and give you an example, the bank locker. So a bank locker is a classic two-key system. The bank manager has a key and you have a key. To open, you need both, but either of you can lock the key. So this is the kind of conceptual backbone for the Bitcoin architecture. Now let's do a small exercise. All of us are very good at maths and accounting. So here is the thing. A factor of 12, if you have to do factorization, I mean, I'm sure a lot of the kids are doing it. So factors of 12 are 2, 3, 4, and 6. Now here is an exercise for you. Find the factors of 4, 3, 8, 6. Rohit, we'll give the participants 10 to 15 seconds. Let me know what is the answer which comes up.
Yes, Pradeep, we got an answer. It's 2, 3, 6, 17, and 43.
Wow, awesome. Now, the audience is super sharp. They managed to get the answers. So the answers are 2, 3, 6, 17, and 43. Now, 2, 3, 6 is fairly easy. There are rules for 2, 3, 6. But 17 and 43 is tricky. So unless you know one of the answers is 17 or one of the answers is 43, it takes a lot of effort to get this answer because these are prime numbers. So so we define here an important term which is called semi-prime. Semi-prime is a product of two prime numbers. And this again is in the this again is forms the backbone of the Bitcoin architecture. Now, we all know that the prime numbers, you will find a lot of prime numbers till let's say 1000, but after that the prime numbers keep decreasing. Now, mathematically, finding prime numbers becomes very, very, very difficult as the numbers become big. And then finding a semi-prime becomes difficult because it's a product of two prime numbers. So given a semi-prime, it's almost Herculean to find the two answers. Rohit, can you launch a poll?
Yes, I will launch it. Here it goes. It is for 15 seconds.
Yeah. So essentially what we want to know is, like for example, the audience quickly managed to find 438 factors. So what is the largest number which has been factorized? Semi-prime. A multiple of two prime numbers. What is the largest number for which people found out those prime numbers?
Yeah. Yes, I'll end the polling. So 45% of them have responded 10 to the power of 100.
Okay. So the audience is quite close. The right answer is 10 to the power 250. So this is the kind of number, humongous number, which has been factorized. And why is that important? Let's go to the next slide. So many of us would have seen this RSA encryption algorithm. So this depends on the prime factorization of large numbers. And this takes a lot of time is what they are reliant on. So when the numbers are large, it's almost impossible to factor a prime number, a semi-prime number. Now, the record in 2009 was RSA 768, which was a 232 digit number. Recently, a few months ago, a 250 digit number has been factorized. And it takes a lot of effort. So a couple of universities collaborated. They used many machines, hundreds of machines, and it took them 2 years to factorize this number. Because it's a very, very mathematically intense process. You have to try it number by number. Because it's a prime number, you have no way of getting to the answer. And the same researchers also estimated that a 1024-bit modulus will take about 2000 years. I mean, maybe now it would have come to about 1000 years, but you know, imagine 100 years ago, a lot of us didn't have cars, we were horseback. So, you know, we are talking about a huge amount of time. Now, I'll spend a few slides on the history of Bitcoin and I'll do a quick calculation on how this public key, private key architecture works. Okay, so the public key private key architecture is not recent. It is 1977 when three MIT scientists got together, and the RSA architecture is named after the last names of these three guys. So they came up with a two key architecture system, like the bank locker example I told you. So there are two keys, one public and one private. And I'll just take you through a small example which shows you how this mechanism works. So step one, select two primes. Of course, here we have small numbers, but in real life, this would be a humongous number. So you have two numbers, P and Q. So step one, select P and Q. Step two, compute P into Q. So you get a semi-prime, 187. Now steps three to five is basically what's called introducing a complication. Now what the backbone is this thing of product of two prime numbers gives you a semi-prime numbers. But just for validation, you add an extra complication. Here, what we have done, we have subtracted both the primes by one, found out another number, added one to it, and then found out the multiples of that. So 17 minus 1 is 16, 10 minus 1 is 11 minus 1 is 10, so you get 160. Now 160 plus 1 is 161, which is a product of 23 into 7. So if you see step number 6, what you have is a public key, which is open to everybody, which is published on the internet. People can see the key. So this key has this number 187 and the verification number 7. And the private key, which is kept secret with you, has the two products, 17 and 11. Now remember, we are talking about huge numbers. So it's almost impossible to factorize it in real time. Steps 3 to 5 are just there to introduce a complication. Now people can either introduce a complication or they can do what is called a padding factor. The padding factor is like saying, I send you a message, but I tell you the first and the last words. Or ignore the first and the last two words of the message. And so it's only known between you and me what to ignore and what to say. So to quickly summarize, basic operation is multiplication of two prime numbers. The public key, I just picked up a random prime number, semi-prime number. The public key is in the cloud, anybody can access it. The private key, which is the product of these two primes, is safely with an individual. And you have the encrypted message. So either of the public key or the private key can open the message because they are equivalent, but they are slightly different. And you can add one additional step. You can do padding or you can complicate it. So this is the backbone of the entire private key public key infrastructure, which is the foundation for the Bitcoin technology. Now, all of us like Bollywood. So you've seen this movie. So I just modified the dialogue of this movie a little bit. So what is the dialogue? Semi-prime ko factorize karna mushkil hi nahi, namumkin hai. So you know this down dialogue. And then of course semi-prime factorization ka intezar 11 mulkon ke researchers kar rahe hain. Actually it's more than 11. And as far as padding is concerned, you remember that awesome scene with Amitabh Bachchan and Helen, which is ye tum janti ho ki padding factor X hai, main janta hun, but police nahi janti. So between the two parties, you can decide on a padding factor and an outsider will not be able to make it out. So RSA 250, which got factorized, is this number. If you see in the bottom, this is this humongous number. So to factor this, even with the best of the computers, takes a huge amount of. Now RSA 1024, which is what many of us use, typically uses a 309 decimal number. And at one point of time, there was a price of $100,000 for anybody who can crack it. RSA 2048, which is highly secure, had a price of $200,000. Now the RSA Corporation has withdrawn the price because nobody could do anything much about it. So, so to summarize, you have a semi-prime, which is a product of two prime numbers. Semi-prime is on a public domain, it published, and the two prime numbers which can factorize it is in the form of a private key. And of course, you can add a little bit of complication that depends on the particular system. So you add a complication and keep it there. Now let's look at a real life practical example how this is applied. So I have A wanting to send a message to B. So what does A do? A picks up B's public key, which is on the cloud, encrypts the message and sends it. Now E, who is in between, cannot read the message. That makes sense. When B tries to tamper with the message, it won't open when B uses his private key to unlock it. So this is on the cloud. This is safe and secure. So this is a case where you encrypt without transferring keys. Remember our earlier example where you have to send the key and there's a danger that the key will get intercepted and your message will get compromised. So here you use two keys, one public key, which is on the cloud, and one private key, which is held safely and securely. Either can open each other's locked message. So this is an encryption kind of message. And now we have a little bit more complicated scenario where A takes her private key, signs the message, which she encrypts it. Then she takes B's public key, encrypts it, sends it to B. B decrypts it with his private key and then uses A's public key to decrypt it. Now, any guesses? You are already, a lot of us are already using this private key concept. Where are you using it? Especially CS, we are using it. Very practical application. Any guesses? Well, we are using it whenever we file our income tax return. So you, nowadays, if you notice your form, right, that one page which comes out, when you finish filing income tax return, the income tax authority gives you an option that you can electronically sign it and send it. What you are essentially doing is you are encrypting it with your private key, and the income tax officer is opening it with his public, with your public key, which is there, you know, available freely. So every time you electronically sign your income tax return and send it to the IT authorities, you are using a private key, public key architecture. Rohit, can you launch the next poll?
Yeah, I will. Love. Yes.
Okay, here's a quick poll. How many cryptocurrencies are there in the market? Approximately. Okay, what are the responses? Oh. Okay, awesome. We have a very aware audience. So there are over 30 different cryptocurrencies. So now that we looked at some of the theoretical aspects, let's jump in and see the kind of cryptocurrency. And so I just took this screenshot from a website called Kraken, which deals with cryptocurrencies. There are at least 34 cryptocurrencies which have a bid and offer kind of thing. So the most popular thing is, of course, Bitcoin with a market cap of 170 billion. And then you have Ethereum, Ripple, Bitcoin Cash, all kind of cryptocurrency. Now, what we'll do is, as an exercise, we'll do our own cryptocurrency. So let's launch a 35th cryptocurrency, which is our own. Let's start from the beginning. So now, interestingly, if you look at the volatility, and I'll have another slide where we cover the volatility, all these cryptocurrencies are very volatile. So the 24-hour volatility is something like 50%. So let's launch our own cryptocurrency. So what is Bitcoin? It's just a ledger. Now, all of us know that if you have an opening balance and if you have the ledger, then you can easily create the cash flow, P&L, and balance. So let's launch our own cryptocurrency. So basically, it's a ledger where we have an opening balance and then we have a ledger of transactions. So friend Bob starts a private currency and keeps a ledger. So this is how the ledger looks. So you have a series of transactions. A gave to B, B took from C, and so on. Now, the problem is, what if somebody wants to cheat? So when you design a currency, you want it to be robust and strong. So let's take a case where Jack wants to steal some money. So what he does is, he replaces his name with Mary. So instead of him owning three coins, Mary owns three coins. So, you know, imagine a physical situation where the ledger is in the galla and then the manager goes to have a tea, and then Jack comes, rubs his name and puts Mary's name. So you have a problem. Now, how do you solve this problem? Now, we all do it in real life, which is we solve it using what's called a hash function. So the hash function, you can think of it as something like your PAN card number or a civil ID number. Now, the civil ID, I just picked up the Emirates civil ID number. The civil ID is a constant string, standardized number, which is generated irrespective of whether the, you know, person is a male, female, old, young, it doesn't matter. This is a standard number. Just as you have a PAN number, it's a very, very standard number, which has a certain architecture and format, and it's like an extract. So the hash function is essentially an extract of any text. So what does the hash do? It uniquely captures the characteristics of a text. It has a fixed length and it has built-in validation and checks. So imagine a real estate transaction where it's between you and some other party. Now, to prevent somebody from rubbing your name and putting somebody else's name, what do? You say, Mr. Pradeep, PAN number so and so is buying this land from Mr. Rohit, PAN number so and so, right? So this is the hash function. So what has our friend Bob done? He's attached the PAN number along with the transaction. So for every line, he's created a unique number, which is an extract of this line. let's quickly have a function which generates a 128-bit fingerprint for any text. It doesn't matter what is the text, whether it's numbers, numerals, paragraph, 128-bit fingerprint. So you can see this example quickly. So cat has a particular hash function. A white cat has some other hash function. These are completely random. You cannot predict that if you put cat, you will get 93. So if you see here, a small change in the spelling completely changes the hash function. So what you have done, you have put a name, and along with the name, you put a fan number equivalent. Now let us say, generated, right? The algorithm is fairly standard. So Jack gets creative, so he generates. So he cheats, and also, so it is like you change the name and also change the PAN number. Now what do you do? So Bob gets a little upset. So he has to do something to prevent this. So which is where is the next step, which you would have heard the term blockchain. So this is where the term chaining comes from. So what Bob does is something very, very innovative. So Bob generates a hash function which is linked to the previous hash function. So once the first hash function is generated, like the PAN number is generated, PAN number along with the transaction generates a new PAN number. So this PAN number has details of this PAN number also. So he's effectively chaining each and every transaction, right? Now it becomes more difficult to change this ledger because every entry depends on the previous. So fairly straightforward. So it's like every real estate transaction has the PAN number of the previous owners as well. So it becomes a little difficult to break the chain. Now let's say, for example, Jack gets more creative and he uses brute force. He goes and hires a supercomputer, and overnight he takes the register and changes each and every entry. Possible. I mean, if Jack is motivated, he can do this. Which is where we come up with another interesting concept. But before we jump onto that concept, can you quickly tell me who is the celebrity? A very elegant lady and celebrity. So, any answers?
Yeah, Pradeep. I think it's Kate Middleton. You have responded.
Oh, okay, awesome. People know her. Now, if you look at celebrity, you notice that a number of them have this problem, which is they won't repeat their trust in the public. They will always wear something new and something attractive, something trend-setting. So this brings us to the other concept, which is called number used only once or nonce. Now we have already seen this implementation in real life, and we have used this concept. So can you quickly tell me one or two applications where you have used it? All of us have used this number used only once. Rohit, any answers?
Yeah, it's OTP, one-time password.
Awesome. Oh, awesome. So all of us have done OTP transactions. So OTP uses a similar concept to number used only once. And every time you do a banking transaction, you know, you open your banking website, log in, then go to pick up your tea from the kitchen. By the time you come back, it says session timed out, right? So HTTPS concept also uses this number used only once. So a number used only once is an arbitrary number which can be used only once in a transaction. So for every transaction, there is a unique code. So in our example, what does friend Bob do? You see these purple arrows? Bob has created a complication. He's introduced a rule where it says, add any random number here so that the last two digits of the hash function are 00. You can have another rule which says the last number of the hash function is a even number or an odd number. You can have any kind of complication. So now Bob has introduced this complication. So because of this complication, what happens? Jack gives up because it becomes almost impossible to duplicate this register, because not only is it linked to each and every entry, but there is also a random code which has its own rule which you don't know. So it's almost impossible to crack it. So we have designed a currency which is fairly strong. So this is the backbone of Bitcoin. So what did Bob do? After a few records, he realized that his ledger is getting filled up. So he wrote 5,000 transactions and converted them into a one-page spreadsheet. Forward. So you know, every time your ledger gets over, you finish one book and go on to a new book. So this is what is called block in a Bitcoin architecture. So when people talk about blockchain, this is the block. This is one ledger book. And then Mary checked all the transactions. So she's that auditor who's using a green pen, takes all the transactions and says it's fine. So these are guys who are called miners. So they are the checkers. And then what did Bob do for extra security? He created a copy of this register in over 5,000 computers all over the world. So these are called nodes. So this is the Bitcoin architecture. You have blocks which have a register of transactions. There are miners who check it. And then there are these nodes which hold these transactions. So block is a series of transactions. Every node is chained. So every block is chained with another block. And the node is a digital computer. So it keeps on writing the blocks onto the blockchain. And just like heartbeat, the Bitcoin blockchain updates every 10 minutes. So every 10 minutes, it will check for a transaction and update itself. If a transaction, if a block is created, it just updates itself. There is no master computer. It's the ultimate in decentralized computing. Now, there is another architecture which is very similar to this decentralized kind of thing. And I'm sure a number of us have used it, which is the BitTorrent. So BitTorrent, again, there are a number of computers sharing the same file. It is spread across many geographies, architecture, so you have no idea where the original file is, right? Now, so the blockchain cannot be changed. Once it's frozen, it's done. You can only keep adding new transactions. And it's updated simultaneously on all the computers. So here is a quick 2017 map of the world as to where various nodes are. So these are the nodes which all carry the Bitcoin blockchain. A couple of interesting things. If you notice, there are a lot of nodes in Canada and in Northern Europe. Why? Because it's cold there. And see, the blockchain architecture needs a lot of PC processing power, and that generates heat. Typically, you have it in the cold places because heating costs are less. You also have it in Venezuela. Why? Because Venezuela used to subsidize the electricity. Now you'll notice there's virtually nothing in Central Africa and even in parts of India. Why? Because electricity is very expensive and these places are hot and humid. So all these processes generate tons of heat. So to summarize a few more blockchain related terms, what is a wallet? A wallet is a public key, as simple as that. A wallet is a long string of numbers. It's a public key. Everybody can see what's a wallet. This contains Bitcoins. And what's a digital signature? Your digital signature is private key. Every time you do a transaction, you sign it with your private key, your digital signature, and the transaction goes from your wallet. So it's as simple as that. Now let's take a step backwards and look at a typical digital transaction. Let's look at a farmer who makes a little bit of wheat in his farm, and then he goes to the village level aggregator. Who then goes to the district level and who goes to the national stockage. From there, it goes to somebody big like Reliance, Fresh, or Big Bazaar, one of these guys. They will send it to the city. So let's say they will send it to Surat city and it will go to the Surat stockist. From there, it will go to the local shop, and from there, it will go to a homemaker who probably carries 5 kilos. Now the commodity moves left to right and the cash moves from right to left. Now, despite whatever you might say about consumer being the king or power is with the farmer, we like farmers. The reality is that these two big guys in the middle, Reliance, Farm Fresh, or whoever, like Cargill, whoever is the national stockist, these guys have the power. Now, let's look at a typical Bitcoin transaction to see how the power is distributed. So let us say Rob wants to pay Laura 0.3 Bitcoins. And he is agreeing to pay a commission of 1%. Now, nothing is free in Bitcoin. You know, the only thing free is mother's love. Everything else you have to pay. So even to do every Bitcoin transaction, you have to pay a commission. So Rob is willing to pay 1% commission. Okay, good. Now here are a couple of icons. So what Rob does is, from his wallet, he signs it with his golden private key. And it goes in the pool. Now in the pool, what happens is validators validate the transaction. So they take this transaction and unlock it with the public and, you know, ensure that it's a legitimate transaction. So if you see the blue dot, these are all the individual transactions. So all these individual transactions are lying in a pool. Now what happens? Now miners pick up these transactions based on their criteria and create what's called blocks. So a block will have a number of transactions. And then these miners have to solve a mathematical puzzle. So miner 1, miner 2, miner 3. Whoever solves the mathematical puzzle first wins, and the block gets added to the block. So fairly straightforward. And the power is completely distributed. So it depends on the various nodes and the miners. It's a fairly democratic system. So in our case, let's say block 4, where our transaction was there, gets added. Rob transaction goes through. So what is it? This is a ledger entry. So you will do debit Rob, credit Laura. And what will you do? The validator will get a 1% commission. And the miner will get a reward for verifying this transaction and creating this block. Now, a couple of other concepts with the Bitcoin world. So what is blockchain mining? The miners are like, you know, like the central stockist or wholesalers. So they get reward for validating the block. And this reward has been dropping down over the last few years. So in 2009, you would get 50 Bitcoin every time you mine a block. Today it is 6.25 and keep on dropping. Now a quick slide on proof of work and proof of stake. So imagine this is like retailer and stockist. So on the left, you have the stockist, who is like the wholesaler who kind of validates the transaction. Now the retailer is like Reliance Fresh, you know. Reliance Fresh power comes from being in every nook and cranny. So anytime, let's say you want to do a Bitcoin transaction of Reliance, that's good. You go to your nearest validator. So this is your retailer on the right, and on the left you have the stockist or the wholesaler. Now retailer's power is reach. Stockist power is the processing power. Or stockist power in real life is the amount of material he has. So if somebody calls him saying, "Boss, dustan chahiye," the stockist should be able to say, "Yes, yes, I'll arrange for it." So this is the differentiation between these two guys. So one focuses on computational power, other focuses on reach. Miners get reward when they solve the block. Validators collect transaction fees. And then for any hacker to succeed, you need to have more than 51% network, which is kind of impossible. Now a quick summary slide. If we start from top, Rob opens his wallet, scans the recipient's address, public key, where the Bitcoin is supposed to go. Then he fills in the amount, sends. The wallet is signed using his private key. The transaction goes through various nodes. Miners and validators validate it. Mining happens. New Bitcoin is created. And then Laura sees the confirmation. So it's a fairly democratic and straightforward process. So to summarize, it's just a blockchain is nothing but just a ledger. It's just a ledger which has the various entries. And using that, you create transactions. Now, you say this is no big deal. Why can't I have my own blockchain mining rig? What if I don't use my PC during the day or during the night? So why don't I make it into a Bitcoin miner? You know, I can also participate, and that is true. In the beginning, a lot of the Bitcoin mining equipment was individuals and amateurs, and you can still participate. But what is your competition? And your competition is these kind of guys. So this is a server farm in Northern Canada. If you want to know how big it is, focus on this red circle. This is a forklift. So this is how big and giant this server farm is. So you are competing with the likes of these guys for Bitcoin mining. Now, the problem is the Bitcoin's founders kind of figured out that this will happen. So what happens if you have too many of these big guys? You again come back to the same problem, which is a central authority. So the big guys will kind of decide the rules. And after a period of time, the big guys will want to make the rules their way, right? And this is what is the problem we have with, let's say, central banks or centrally operated agents. After some time, they, you know, like play hooky. So what the Bitcoin's founders did was, they wanted to reward widespread participation. Which is why they said, the mathematical problem which a miner solves relies on effort and luck. What do I mean by luck? Slide. So let's say the Bitcoin network would say the target for next block is dot of zeros and 0.5. Now you have to have a hash which has a number less than this. So if you come up with 3, it will get rejected. If you come up with D, it will get rejected because D in hexadecimal is bigger than 5. Only when you come up with 4 will the block go. Now remember our diagram. You see, this hash function is completely unpredictable. You have no way of knowing whether 9 will come first or 3 will come first. One small change, like for example here, if you see just one spelling mistake and the hash function is completely random and completely different. So for you to get a target hash function, you need to have a lot of computing power, yes, and you also need to be lucky. Right? So this is like the lottery system, right? How do you game a lottery? Let's say lottery has 100 tickets. You can buy 90 tickets. And the probability of you getting the lottery is very high. Or you can be that you just walks in one day and buys the 9th, that is winning. Right? So this is the beauty of Bitcoin architecture, which is computational power and luck. Now, here is a typical block. This was mined in 2017. If you notice, the output is something like 800 Bitcoin. Transaction fee is 1.4 Bitcoin, so something like 0.25% is the transaction fee. Number used only once. So this is the number which changed this block to the other remaining blocks. Block reward is 12.5 Bitcoin. So whoever binds this, this guy called Antpool. So Antpool gets 12.5 Bitcoin by the network reward. And this is the hash. This is the hash, completely unpredictable and you cannot do anything about it. Whoever lucky gets it. Now, we've gone over the architecture of Bitcoin fairly great detail. Now you can always read up online. This is just to give you a overview. I mean, there are a lot of technical papers and a lot of the PhD research right now is on kind of architecture. Now we'll look at something a little bit more practical, which is risk and challenges in Bitcoin. Aha, dark screen. Yeah, and I apologize, you know, in the beginning we again had dark screen where, you know, my output went off. So this is a quote by a very famous sports personality. You know, everybody has a plan till they get punched in the face. So what is that punch which may get delivered to not only Bitcoin but the entire banking architecture? By the way, this quote is from Mike Tyson. So he's a very famous boxer who has this extra aggressive style. Now the punch which can happen is this thing called quantum computers. Now, this is again cutting edge research. I just put a schematic. This entire diagram would probably fit 3 or 4 rooms, all for a chip. If you see the chip here, the chip is of the size of the palm of your hand. And if you see the complication, it has to be shielded in terms of radiation. You need vacuum. You need -273 degrees Celsius temperature for you to have this quantum computer stable and running. But once you have this quantum computer stable and running, it can really do a lot of interesting things. So instead of 0 and 1, which the conventional computer has, a quantum computer has many states. Now, how does this affect Bitcoin? So let's look at a little bit of history of Bitcoin. So end of 2008 is when this paper got published. From 09 to 10, nothing much happened. In fact, a guy called Smoke Too Much offered 10,000 bitcoins for $50. And nobody, there was no bid. The first transaction happened on 22nd May 2010, where this guy called Laszlo sent 10,000 bitcoins for two pizzas. What is the value of this 10,000 bitcoin today? It'll be something like $90 million. So 2010, bitcoin was worth $50, you know, but 0.001. Today it's worth about $10,000. And if you look at the price graph, Bitcoin's capitalization is around $170 billion. It is right now around 9,000 or so. But what is interesting about Bitcoin is this volatility. Now, if you look at this graph on the top right, you're talking about intraday volatilities of 7%. Now, if you're looking at Bitcoin, you should be prepared for this kind of crazy volatility. Rohit, can you launch the poll, please, the third poll?
Yeah, sure, Pradeep.
Okay, so what is the biggest, single biggest cryptocurrency related fraud? Wow. We have audience with very high expectations. Okay. Let's look at some of the problems with Bitcoin. I mean, one is, of course, volatility. And the other is case study. There's this exchange, there was an exchange called Quadriga Exchange, which used to be at one point the largest Canadian exchange. Now, what happened with that? The owner had all the clients' account under his master account. And he died with the password. Now remember this Bitcoin architecture, everything depends on the private key and the public key. If you lose them, it is bye-bye. So the first problem or first challenge with Bitcoin which you have is that who has the keys? And if the person who has the key dies, you get into big trouble. Now let's look at another interesting case. This lady here, Dr. Ruth Ignatova, her CV is completely awesome. She has a PhD from University of Oxford and Bulgaria University. She is an associate partner at McKinsey & Co. And she was a CEO and CFO of very, very well known. She also had a cool boat. This boat would roam around Dubai, Monaco, Cannes, all these interesting places. She also was featured in one of the paid Forbes. I mean, she was not on the front page of Forbes, but one of those inside pages. This was a paid advertisement. She would frequently be in many seminars across Europe and Dubai and the Middle East. And she made very nice statements. You know, she said digital currency, poverty. She was always everywhere, right? And she was looked upon as a visionary. What did she do? She launched this Bitcoin called One Currency. Remember, I showed you there are something like 35 Bitcoin equivalents cryptocurrencies which are being traded. So she launched this currency, and essentially what happened is she just took the money and ran. So investor lost upwards of $4 billion. Who are the investors? Lot of, as they call, Desis, Indians, Pakistanis, Bangladeshis, Filipinos, people from the Middle East. So she has a case going against her in India. What she did was she transferred all the money to various accounts and then disappeared somewhere in the erstwhile Soviet Republic. So nobody knows where she is. So, I mean, you'll see a lot of presentations that talk about the nice things about Bitcoin and its next revolution, but I just thought I'll give you this other perspective of what are the. So quickly, let's look at a few more cases. There's this man from Michigan. What he did was he had a very nice LinkedIn page. And he portrayed himself as a Bitcoin missionary. He wrote some white papers. And then he will send you an invite. You will accept. And then he will send you an offer saying, I'll get you Bitcoins for cheap. Now, you would think nobody will fall for this. But surprisingly, people gave something like $250,000 to this guy. Then there is this cryptocurrency exchange called LBX, which is closed now because it couldn't pay its creditors. Then there was this company which offered a digital savings scheme. It had nice advertisement in the London Underground, and it got shut down because the money was being diverted to a Chinese firm for trading and speculating in cryptocurrency. Then here's an interesting fraud. Two Indian origin Canadians, what they did was they created a fake Twitter account. And there's this legitimate Bitcoin exchange called HitBTC. So this Twitter account was supposed to help people who had problems. Instead, what they did was, the thing which the banks keeps warning us. Don't give your password to anybody who calls on the behalf of bank. So these guys did the equivalent. They took the private key and went off. Four frauds. There were hackers who managed to get into 5,000 emails, and then they were using the SIM swapping. Then there are a lot of automated attacks. There are these malwares which will, if you, let's say you, I email Rohit a message saying, Rohit, send me 0.3 Bitcoins, here is my wallet. What the automated attack will do is it will replace my wallet with, let's say, Mr. Kesar's wallet. So when Rohit sends, he will think he's sending it to me, but it'll actually go to somebody else. There are something like 22 Google Chrome extensions which try and steal user cryptocurrency addresses. So there are all kind of schemes which are happening. You just have to be alert. So there are fake exchanges online. There is a fraud related, just as we have frauds for IPO, we have frauds for what's called ICO, initial coin offering. Now, there's also a lot of blackmail which happens via Bitcoin. So if you remember the WannaCry computer hackers who hacked your computer and demanded Bitcoins as payments. Now, a quick look at some of the frauds. What happens is, or rather the issues with Bitcoin, first is volatility, tremendous volatility. Second is you have to figure out how to keep the private key and public key safe. Regulatory risk. We don't know which regulations authorize or accept Bitcoin. So there's a lot of gray area here. And of course, fraud risk. There's a lot of fraud risk because this is quite an emerging field. Now, we also have issues of scalability. So let's look at cryptocurrency. Bitcoin has 7 transactions per second. Ethereum, which is a competing cryptocurrency, does 20. How much does Visa do? 24,000 transactions. And PayPal, which is also a digital platform, does something like 193. So scalability is the issue. The other issue is tremendous amount of electricity consumption. So Bitcoin platform, just like they say, the BitTorrent network leeches a lot of bandwidth. Similarly, the Bitcoin platform uses tons of electricity and generates tons of electronic waste. So let's conclude by looking at what are the conclusions for us. Now, on a positive note, our profession in Bitcoin has a lot of overlap. We all want to authenticate transactions. Bitcoin helps with that. We want to reduce cost. Bitcoin is tremendously scalable, and the transaction costs are very low compared to, let's say, the other means of money transfer. The faster processing and prevention of fraud and misrepresentation. So these are the things we all want. Many of us recognize this. I think this is one of the most irritating aspects of dealing with authorities, various authorities. You know, they want everything authenticated and notarized. So a lot of Bitcoin technology can do this function, which is on the fly authentication. So as I mentioned in the olive oil example case, you could have the entire olive oil history online. Now one example that I have kids who are in the school and who are giving 12th is that things like the Central Board of Secondary Education is looking at online certificate. So you don't have to do this procedures on the left. Everything is online and available, and this is all secured by the Bitcoin architecture. Now, as it happens with every new technology, there are these spin-offs and other benefits. So if you look at the entire spectrum, you have Bitcoin and other currencies which are open to all. You can also have things like Dubai Land Registry is looking at the Bitcoin-based architecture to post land records online. Then you have large banks which can deal with their consortium using this technology fairly easily. And of course, you can do a lot of the parent-subsidiary related reconciliation on which a lot of us spend a lot of man hours and effort seamlessly through Bitcoin. Okay, so to conclude, at an individual level, what do you need to do? Let's say you want to look at Bitcoin as an investment. What are the things you need to take care of? Again, I'm not looking at the positive aspect, I'm just looking at the questionable aspect. So the most important thing is the custodian. Who has the custody of your keys? And how are the assets being held? And then you have to ask some very uncomfortable question. It's not nice to talk about things, but you need to ask your custodian, what happens if you die? How will your heirs get the possession of your hard-earned money? And then what happens if there's a fourth major? You know, there is a creditor who wants to take on the exchange. How will you take your Bitcoin? The other important aspect is clearing, which is how is your transaction going to be performed? What are the speeds? What are the commissions? How much will you get? What is the exchange rate? Because remember, you can't use Bitcoins freely. You will have to convert it into dollar or dinar or, you know, any of the currencies. And last, which is the biggest component, is let's say you made 1000% on Bitcoin. How will you show it in your IT returns? Remember, you have to pay tax on your income. And then there is this thing about AML regulation, you know, anti-money laundering. Your counterparty in Bitcoin is somebody whom you don't know. It could be a smuggler or somebody who's a bad character. Of course, you don't know that. But there is a lot of gray area in these kind of regulation. And of course, what happens if there's a litigation on a digital transaction? This is something which is yet to be tested. There's a very interesting case called Van Buren versus United States. This case is expected to be resolved in a month or two, and this will throw a lot of light on digital rights and issues related to digital transactions. And then, of course, on the left, if you see, is Bitcoin legal? Now, initially, RBI banned it. Supreme Court overturned it. Now, the Indian government, again, is working on legislation to ban Bitcoin. Why? Because the Indian government has tremendous power in terms of the centralization of the currency. That thing, which most governments, you know, will not like to give this power. And also from a positive standpoint, it's the government's responsibility to protect the citizens. There's a lot of illegal stuff happening through Bitcoins. If you're looking at it from an organization point of view, I mean, we all work in organization. So one is, will your company be able to cope up with all these changes? That is something that you have to ask. You have to check if Bitcoin or cryptocurrencies are allowed by your regulator. Also reputation. You don't want to be on the newspaper saying there's a hack or your Bitcoins got stolen. Contractual aspect, as I mentioned, is a very, very open area. And of course, you need to be clear that your suppliers and customers are also willing to invest in this kind of architecture. And lastly, one important aspect is in terms of your IT infrastructure. Can your IT infrastructure handle the Bitcoin kind of speeds and the processing required? And then, of course, who keeps the private key? Remember, whoever keeps the private key is the boss. So I can do my own transaction bypassing the organization if I have a private key. So from an organization point of view, questions you need to ask is, when you do a cryptocurrency transaction, is your counterparty regulated in any way? And even, let's say you are looking to open a Bitcoin account, you need to preferably go with somebody who is regulated in some form rather than somebody who is, like, for example, imagine you do a transaction with, let's say, Excite. If you don't get the delivery of your electronic thing which you bought, you can at least go file a complaint. If you go online and buy it from a Chinese website, a product of 10 KD, you cannot do anything. I mean, it is completely out of your hand, right? And then the other last piece of parting advice is that do a few full complete transactions. So for example, do a transaction for $100, buy, sell, convert it back to $100, and see that the $100 reaches your account. So it doesn't matter if you know you 100 becomes 120 or 100 becomes 70 because of volatility. But it's important that you go through a full cycle to get an idea of the timelines, the commissions, and any possible hitches. You know, like when you do a lot of transactions, suddenly people say, oh, I want this authorized signatory, or get me itema tokia. And you know, there are always these complications which you need to be aware of. So preferably do a few full transactions with minimal amount. So thank you for being such a nice audience. That brings me to question and answers. So Rohit, can you please read out the question?
I will hand it over to Sriram. So he will take it up from here.
Okay, great. Thanks.
Pradeep, thank you so much. I think this is really wonderful. You know, we went through a bit of a completely new world and with all cryptic rules and regulations to follow. And I think it's like, you know, landing into altogether a new planet and looking at completely a new whole world of business, you know, that's been set up. So we have got a few questions, Pradeep, for you from the participants. And some of them, they have been touched in one way or the other while you were talking. So I'll just touch upon a few of them for you to elaborate a little. So one is related to the Van Buren case. So just one of our participants have asked, why is it important? And if you can shed a little more light on what this case is all about. So that is the first question.
Okay, great. Let me go to this. This is Van Buren versus United States. Now, Nathan Van Buren was a police officer with the Georgia Police Department. He had the he was the authorized user for the police database, the computer cell. Now, he got into financial difficulties, and then whoever lent him money, he said, okay, you cannot repay me money. Give me information. So friend Nathan was passing on information of various kinds from the police database to this guy. And then the FBI got hold of it, and then they laid a trap for him. So he, in exchange for money, gave information. Now this is the background, this is fairly straightforward. You know, this is like the CID episode kind of thing. But the important thing here is Nathan Van Buren's lawyers went and sued saying, this guy is an authorized user. So as an authorized user, he has access to all the data, and you cannot tell him what he can or cannot do with this data. So this is going to be a landmark case where the US Supreme Court is going to define who are authorized, what is meant by access. Now remember, the US regulations which are governing this entire cyberspace related issues were written in 1986. So that is a regulation called CFAA, which is a very, very old regulation. And it was envisaged for a mainframe kind of environment where somebody will forcibly get in or somebody will commit an arson. It didn't envisage a world where, you know, people can steal cryptocurrencies or people can do unauthorized access. So this case is where we'll see an overhaul of the regulations. And I think right now there's a tons of regulatory confusion across the world. Like, for example, Kuwait doesn't have a cryptocurrency or a Bitcoin governing regulation. There is no regulation. There is money laundering regulation, and there are regulations on electronic commerce. But this is a wild, wild west field. So hopefully this case will throw more light and clarify the issue.
Thank you, Pradeep. The next question in the line is, there's a new currency that's coming up called Pi. So what's your take on that, and is that reliable? From one of our member participants.
The new currency is like an IPO, you know. Now in the IPO market, what do you look for? You look for reliability of the promoter and how solid the business is. But unfortunately for cryptocurrency, you don't know much about the promoters because mostly they are young kids. You don't know much about the underlying architecture. So personally, what I would do is I would stick with one of those. You know, I showed you a list of 35 top currencies and the market cap. What I would stick to is, if you have some really ultra speculative money, you can put a little bit in that. But otherwise, if you want a little bit of stability, stick to some of the established currencies. So you can look at Bitcoin, Bitcoin Cash, Ethereum, Ripple. These are all currencies where the bid-ask spread will be low. You can get into these currencies, you know, as all of us know, getting into a security is very easy. When it's time to get out, that's when liquidity dries up.
Yeah. The next question is, we got a couple of questions more, you know, we'll quickly take it as the time is also, you know, getting short. The question is about the quantum computer. You know, of course you covered it and you showed us the size and all that. So what is the timeline? You know, when do you expect, you know, such things would be, you know, hitting us with, you know, the timeline basically on the quantum computers?
Okay, very, very interesting question. Now, let me elaborate a little bit, if I can. I'll just take 2 minutes. Now, a conventional computer, let me give an example. Let's say your boss tells you, here are 10 houses. Go and check them and tell me which is the best house. Okay, so your boss is giving you an assignment. How will you do it? You will go to first house, make a report, go through a checklist. Next day, you will go to the second house, make a checklist, and like this, you will spend 10 days. And on the 11th day, you will have a report to the boss saying, boss, house number 5 is good, right? So this is how a conventional computer operates. So you have to evaluate each and every option, especially for fields like cryptography or banking security. What a quantum computer will do is, imagine if you can make 10 copies of yourself. What will you do? Each of you will go into one house and your assignment will get over in a day, right? And now imagine if you can make 100 copies of yourself. You will have 10 people going to a house and you will get your results in 5 minutes, right? So what a quantum computer does is it can look parallelly at many possible options simultaneously, unlike a conventional computer. Now, quantum computers are very much in infancy because the cooling requirements are tremendously large. But in terms of speed, there is some very, very interesting news. So IBM used to have something what's called a 32, I mean, they have a strange system of volume. So they had something, a quantum computer, which could do 32 qubits. And Honeywell recently jumped up to 64. And Honeywell is offering it for private parties and researchers at something like $10,000 per hour. So I think this will catch speed. And once this catches speed, then a lot of our rules need to be rewritten, especially related to cryptography and banking security and things like that. Now, the flip side of quantum computers is, as I gave an example, if you have 100 copies of yourself, yeah, you can get your result in 2 minutes, right? But what will happen is, all the 100 copies won't be the nice, sincere guy who does work. Two of them will say, yeah, Chodo, I don't feel like working today, you know, I'm going to the movies, right? So the problem with quantum computers is that the error rates are very high. So you can look at number of multiple pathways, but there are high error rates, which is why you have to do a couple of iterations. But we are looking at interesting times. In terms of timelines, I think, you know, let's say next 5 to 10 years should be safe. After that, we don't.
Great. Thanks, Pradeep. The last question for the evening is, what happens if the Bitcoin blockchain becomes too big? That is a question. I guess the participant is talking about its impact on the existing other, you know, business and economy. That is, I think, where he's alluding the question to.
Yeah. Right now, the Bitcoin architecture is something like 16 or 17 GB of data. So, one way to look at this problem is, let's say you want to buy a land, right? And you want to buy a land, what do? You first go and see who is the owner of the land, right? And whether he has any banking lien or anything like that, right? So you look at who owns the land, and then you find out who owned the land before him. So let's say Ali owned the land, and before that, his father Ahmed owned the land. And before that, somebody called Thomas owned the land. So you do a little bit of this tracing, you know, when do you do real estate transaction. Now, if you tell me who owned it before Thomas, the registrar will say, listen, dude, it is the British period. We don't have those records. They're in archive, right? Right. This is what the registrar will say. He says, focus on this dude, Ali. Look at the, you know, encumbrances and no lien certificate, and then move on. So with Bitcoin, something similar is likely to happen. Once the blockchain becomes huge, part of the block will go to archive. And you'll just have the remaining blocks, which will be the active transaction. Now, some of the newer cryptocurrencies are also looking at something like incremental register being there with all the nodes. So there's an archival of the big register, and then just the pages are there, which are live. So these are the techniques which I think the blockchain experts will rely on. But this is a solvable problem. I mean, it's a very legitimate problem, but it's a solvable problem. Same like what happens with land register, or same with like what happens with school records. You know, if you go and say, I passed out in 1985, give me a record, the principal will say, come after a week. You know, I don't have any records. I just have records from, let's say, 2005 onwards. Yeah. Right, so a similar kind of a solution is expected to happen.
Thank you, Pradeep. It was really fun, you know, learning a lot of new things from you personally for me. So without much delay, I hand over to CA Anoop Dhan to come over and present the word of thanks for us. Thank you.
I would also like to thank the DTA committee members for giving me this opportunity and for the excellent support and encouragement. I think they handheld me in a number of ways, and there were a lot of useful suggestions. And it's an absolute pleasure to be with such an august and esteemed body. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Pradeep.
Good evening, fellow members and guests. CP events in future will give us more eggs as well to put in those baskets. Miners, blocks, and ledgers, which for us, wallet is something which we put in the back pocket of our trouser. Ledgers is something which we deal with in and out during dealing with our auditors, but he put new dimensions to these terminologies, and they were quite well explained and quite well understood as well. Internet was an issue to begin. Initial glitches, we were able to overcome that. Thanks, Pradeep. We were expecting some sort of that during the evening hours, and we had those glitches, but very effectively and very in a nice and quick way, they were sorted out. Overall, it was a wonderful session, something which, as CA Sriram mentioned, that it was something very, very, it's a new technology, new thing in the industry, and we all are learning. But your session, Pradeep, gave us a very, very easy and lucid way to understand what Bitcoin is. Though some of those maths, prime and semi-prime numbers were a little bit tangent to me, but I'll take a private session in private with you to understand them. But it was really a wonderful session. You mentioned about Bitcoin mining, if we can do that in the evening hours. I thought that, yes, we can, if Kuwait internet is a little better than what it is. But then when you showed me those server farms, suddenly my hopes came crashing down. In all, a wonderful session. I thanks once again to all the participants and all the guests, all the members who took time out to attend this. Pradeep, thank you so much once again. And I also want to remind all our members that 1st July, please join us at 6 p.m. for virtual celebration of CA Day. It would be we would be launching our e-journal as well on that day. So look forward to seeing you all again on 1st July, 6 p.m. Thanks once again to Pradeep, all the members, all the guests who took time out to attend this session. Thank you so much. With that, we close the session. Thank you. See you once again on 1st July, 6 p.m. Bye.